organization. It's a methodology to tune expectations between different entities, let's say. I am this guy. This email may be given is student investigation. I am assigned with the University of Luxembourg currently. At the end of this month, I will start freelancing activity. So this is the index of the presentation. I will just go through the slides. So what is HPC BIOS? It is an effort concerned with the user's ability to handle tasks on computational platforms, be it HPC, grids, clouds, or even your laptop, in a uniform and painless manner, as much as that is technically feasible. Some things are possible, some others not. Here we care about the things that are possible. It is defined at three levels. One is structured documentation. The second is policies automation. There is this concept of bundles that we are going to see. Then it's wrapping code to satisfy the above and provide cheap build sets. That's another concept that we are going to visit. I hope you managed to pay attention to the previous two presentations about Quotients and Easy Build, because they are kind of prerequisites for what's being presented here. And at present, HPC BIOS is apparently more of open source documentation because there is a big synergy with EasyBuild. EasyBuild provides the language for describing many of the things that we see here. The resulting easy configs, for example, end up as part of the EasyBuild repository. And the advantage of this that I favor is that we end up writing this in Python rather than shell code, which is what I could be doing if EasyBuild was not there. So who may care about HPC BIOS? It could be users involved in scientific computing, experts and sysadmins involved in support of scientific codes. I expect these people to come to understand faster what this HPC BIOS business is about. And then we have developers and employers of EasyBuild, which is the vehicle of choice, for the objectives that concern HPC software. So here is an interesting histogram from a survey that was done maybe a year before I even met this field. We were polling a group of HPC users from a number of countries about the foundation software libraries that they depend on. And we came up with this kind of histogram, and you can see here some names that you probably have met elsewhere. And the interesting stuff about it, and how it connects with the previous presentation, is that you will quickly notice that a good bunch of these parts of the histogram relate to this tool chain that you can find on EasyBuild called Goalt. And if you check Dell, this is a Layback, this is a W, this is Atlas, and you have a few more linear algebra interfaces that are being covered here, Lux, Scalapack, Elepack, and so on. There is also an alternative toolchain to Goalt called Goalt, which is basically the same like this, but without this bar, without this piece of software, the Atlas component, it instead has OpenBLAS, that's what this O stands for. And for people that haven't heard OpenBLAS, it is in effect a replacement of PROTOBLAS. Theory has it that it is better, but I prefer to hear what people comment about. So the summary is that we have some user needs that on the substrate level can be served quite well from two chains. And interestingly, this bar here corresponds to the Intel vendor-provided set of libraries for math operations that can replace these two chains. I kind of simplified my talk because I didn't mention anything about compilers and MPI stacks that are part of the tool chains. But the bottom line is that you can have selections of components that can replace each other, and on top of it, build the applications that users care about, like for example this one, which is the GNU Scientific Library. So you could build TSL with any of these three, and you may have, if you have enough large enough user base, you will have people that care about all three different variations of fields. Before I leave this slide, I will just mention that everything that you see here, ASOK in red, has some kind of this is built to be provided automatically, which is good. It's a way to demonstrate that there is good progress with the substrate. Now, common stumbling blocks for users are basically the following. We have need for common tools for handling software, from the very classic ones like TAR compressors, AutoCons, AutoMate, Bison, CMake, whatever. We have seen many times possible. Then we need libraries and software that is common for math operations and other foundation libraries in general. It could be for graph handling, for instance. We often have common needs for software popular with scientific communities like R, Python, components of these languages, and so on. And finally, on an XPC platform, it's an advantage to have not a single version of a given software component, but multiple, because that can help very much for differential debugging. So I think that most people have been playing with software. At some point, they find out that having two, three versions of a given package is a big advantage, because you can hit a bug that is apparent on only one of them, and then you can go via differential debugging to trace cause. And one more point as regards the context and motivation of this. About 2 years ago, I landed in Luxembourg in the middle of a bioinformatics community, and I realized that all these people are actually providing little pieces of all these tools without really much central coordination, and there was a lot of overlap of work. Eventually, we can provide this as modules, but then you arrive at another problem. These are 3 times 20, 60 pieces. If you really want to do module load all these things individually, that's not really a great way to manage the scientific environment. So maybe we can do something by packing these things together, so that we can automate a lot of the quality of the work. So objectives that we can think of is, first of all, we like to have freedom to define the software environment at different levels. At the level of the system, which is what most sysadmins and user support centers care about. At the level of the group, because users collaborate in projects and they often have common needs, and they don't want to build this particular version of that tool 10 times because there are 10 users, they don't have their own customized build. And then the level of the individual user. And actually that is feasible by employing modules, because modules allow you to have this variable called module path that can have many components, and as soon as you add many pieces on this module path, you can actually implement this kind of organization. Currently what we have in production in Luxembourg and works relatively well is the combination of this and this. This is still possible if users are willing to implement it, but I haven't seen it yet getting traction. Now, as regards the reproducibility of software builds, this could be feasible by using Easybuild. And there is an apparent conflict between agility, move versions forward, and stability and backward compatibility. So there is a challenge there. How do we handle that? Our organization currently in Luxembourg is to only change the default versions when we pass through a maintenance window, so that users don't get surprised and their jobs break in the middle of a big run. But once we pass a maintenance window, then we have all the incentives to promote the software versions. So how can you let users have both agility and stability? We will see a concept of build sets that will allow to perfect rollback and even roll forward. So I might even have a default version right now. I will have a maintenance window in 2 months, but I can still provide to my users the build set that will become a default in advance so that they can test it when they need that. So XP-Spice is an effort to improve the source environment. It strives to minimize the time that people spend with individual sites or systems configuration. The most well-served domains currently are these, math, bioinfo, and life sciences, but more scientific domains are considered. It's about standardization and producing the user experience across sites, systems, and so on. It could even be applied on lab. The gradients, as we said, is this, motion CZ build, and we'll see now the concepts of build sets and bundles. Sometimes I use the word policy for the word bundle, keep it in your mind so that you understand the context. Let's have a look at it. So I ask for modules that have this kind of pattern, and I get this list. I think it's important to realize straight away on this slide that this is build sets, it's collections of software, and the section that you see up here is just a small part of basically, I think at this slide I see this one. It's a by category view of the builds of this particular set. And what is going on here? These are different big collections of builds and modules that have happened over the last year. Inside them, we have many, many modules that can be collectively organized in these bundles. For example, if I have a user that asks me, give me back the software that we provided last year to my informatics, he can very easily do module add this one and this one. And you will get the software environment for the mathematics of that time. We have currently a nominal lifetime of these pieces of 12 months, but this is a site-specific choice how long to keep them. What matters is that people can go back, can do a rollback, or can even go forward, regardless of what is your default pieces at this given moment in time. And they can select the same environment here. So the two keywords we take from the slide is this two. And let's see how this correlates with scientific activity. The open source math libraries, it's the HPC BIOS underscore math, is this collection. It's this set of popular libraries that we saw with arrows in the screenshot before. Then we have policies about editors and scripting tools, performance testing and profile tools, and so on. You may wonder where these numbers come from. As we'll see in the next slide, the same effort has occurred elsewhere in the US between 6 Department of Defense HPC sites, and they have defined this kind of policies, objectives, and they assign some numbers. So, because of backward compatibility, let's say, we have these fancy numbers over there. So this is exactly what I described before. There is this concept of baseline configuration. Let's have a look at this, because it's easier to understand by saying So we have a number of HPC sites. The user base is shared between them. And they want to present what features they give to the users in a structured manner so that the user can in advance know where he has a good chance of running his software even before applying for access. And here you see potential topics, multiple version software, scratch based intention type, Kerberos, Ticket Life, environment variables, new names, looking cells. I will go quickly, editors, debuggers. Users' notices, common change control rollbacks, MPI test suite, and so on. There are a few things that you want to standardize across HPC sites. What matters is that when you have this, then the users can quickly know exactly in which place they have a good chance of getting their job done. And you don't get support tickets for no reason. And the same idea has been rephrased in HPC BIOS. Over here, the numbers that you see this tile, they are, let's say, backward compatible with the list that we saw before, while these ones are new policies that have been invented. A particular way of delivering is described here. And there are a few more about bioinformatics, GPUs, and so on. They are in development, some of them. The concept, actually, it is quite common when you have collaborations. For example, if you have heard of the Brace and Beza, they have defined common production environment. But it is not always documented all that much on the site basis. And here is an effort to improve on this. How to contribute back? Which type of software code comes in the sky project objectives? The answer is modules and easy build are the things that you have to look at. And then if you manage to automate certain of the objectives, then we should turn it into a component of HPC BIOS, and this sits on GitHub. So a classic pull request is the way to handle this. Things are relevant for HPC BIOS when they are applicable across two sites. So if you have rough consensus and something that the people in two sites, they believe that it's the common denominator about how to organize the environment, I think that could be a good candidate for this collection. Of course, different people have different needs. And here are the challenges. It is actually unknown territory, which other policy objectives matter. At the moment, we are actually abusing EasyBuild's two chains for what are the bundles. That has a side effect that it constrains functionality to homogeneous targets. For instance, if you want to bring up debuggers, you may have a difficulty if you want both Intel and GCC compiled debuggers. There are some constraints there that have to be taken into account. This approach is more of a hack and may have to be revisited. Then another challenge that is more of daily practice, when you have a site with some nodes with GPUs, for example, some nodes without, or other architectural features, you can see some there. If you want to have the shortest the shortest amount of time when you release a new build set, how do you schedule this optimally? At the moment I do this manually, and we may have tools eventually to get this done quickly. There are also other things that have to be taken into account. Actually, these do relate to easy build, regardless if you care about the HPC BIOS. If you want to build Atlas or FSTW, they do some kind of auto-tuning. So in that case, you will care about how you run your build, because you may end up in a non-optimal configuration. Finally, there are some discrepancies about how the ordering of modules is done. The loose version and modules and LMOD have different understanding of what is bigger than what. And this can lead to surprises by the users when they load the default. Because the default is supposed to be the latest, but the latest is not exactly what people expect all the time. I'm in the last slide, let's say. So, there is a link of references, some activity on GitHub, how to use it. Basically, if you download this build and you try this with a recursive build, theoretically, you get much of what you saw in that slide built in one shot. Of course, it will take some time, but that's the way you do it. Read the HPC BIOS objectives, and brush extent, and so on. That's it.
Questions for Fogis?
Yeah, what does HPC BIOS stand for?
It's historic, let's say. In the beginning, this started in the context of bioinformatics activity. So the bio was bioinformatics. Then it is generalized. For me now it's just the name and address. I wonder if you have faced this kind of problems if you run this exercise. How many of your computer support here? Have you seen this kind of problems?
Yeah, if people switch sites, they suddenly run into some problems. Close it down here. And